Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. This edition is coming out on October 13th. Spooky. So with that, we've got a returning guest coming to the show from episode 48. We've got returning Rubi Roberts. Yes. Welcome back.
Hi. Hi. How are you?
I'm not bad, not bad. We had our trials and tribulations off the recording. Me with yes. you with getting the police out, and me
yes.
trimming my beard too close. So clearly on the same level. So I was surprised though when I did go back, like I was saying before, that when I was going back, going, oh, I must have been last year. And we did kind of have a catch up last year for yeah. Respectful Wrestling. They had a show we talked about in February 2022, but. I can't believe it was pandemic, April 2021, one of the first
I know.
Just about the start of the second season, I think it was, but still really, really early on. So we've got yes. quite a lot to catch up on.
It's been an exciting 2 years.
Absolutely. Just seeing your social media and your transformation, everything that you've done in the last 2 years. We'll try and pick up on some of it. Clearly not all of it, because we'll be here yeah. for hours otherwise. And
yes.
There's only so much that people could take of my voice, so that's.
I've been told the same.
Be fine. It's nice when it's different voices. With me speaking about, I don't know, dinosaurs and WrestleZone. Right. Okay. So, to catch up then. So a lot that has happened. We won't because shows came back. So that's kind of a good starting point to go
yes.
from. So you had this big body transformation during the pandemic and just about. Before the pandemic as well, that you became, you went from Rubi Roberts with the big singlet with the camo
yes.
on, and then you came out of it, the basic bitch slayer. You had the pleather leggings. You had you were looking yes. totally different.
The t-shirt.
of course, which we have a question about the t-shirt, so I will get into that Ooh. At some point in the future in this episode. So go back, way back to the start of shows again. How did you kind of fill your time? Because like, so we started speaking a year into the pandemic on this podcast.
Yes.
So we're still, what, another 6 months before shows began again? So do you remember what it was like when you found out shows are coming back?
I was so unbelievably happy when I found out shows came back. During the pandemic, I actually I volunteered as a key worker. So I was working the whole way through the pandemic, which actually was one of those things. It was a sort of blessing in disguise. Everybody else got time off, but I got time to sort of focus on keeping busy and working on my physical health, exercise, just constantly just working on when shows come back. I want to be fit. I want to be ready. I want to be like straight out the gate. Which thankfully that is what happened. The minute shows came back, I was just elated, and I was immediately like, right, okay, where are we going? Where am I sending CVs? Like, let's just hit everyone. And yeah, it was just one of those. I was just so finally glad to get started, because my debut was literally right before COVID hit. So I'd had one match and then everything stopped. And it was really good to sort of get the time to get myself to more of a place where I felt like I looked the way I wanted to look. I was moving the way I wanted to move. I was wrestling the way I wanted to. But it was also, it's just, there's an energy it shows. You'll have felt it yourself when you go to a live wrestling show. There's like an energy that sort of goes through the performers, the crowd, everyone. And I miss that so much. So it's see getting to get back into shows and getting to see people you hadn't seen for nearly 3 years and really feel that energy again and how excited everybody was. It was just amazing.
And you're saying it with that as well, you got your first match jitters out of the way, that they were done before the pandemic. So when you came
yeah.
back, you had that kind of pressure. I mean, there's still pressure when the first match back anyway, but there wasn't yeah. as much. It wasn't like it was you're not brand new first match. You're new in form, but you're not new to wrestling. You'd already had your first match. So
yeah, we came out for the second debut as the sort of Gen 2 evolution. We started off as my primary evolution, and then second evolution came out after pandemic, and we're just going to see how many more evolutions we can go through before I get told I have to stop wrestling.
You're now at your Charmeleon or
Yes.
War Turtle phase.
Yes.
Of wrestling. There you go. Pokemon references. Tick that
War
one
Turtle,
off.
We'll go with that. Suits the blue.
There we go. Of course. Yeah, makes sense. Did you find there was a difference? You said that you got into the shape you wanted to get into for coming back. Did you feel that there was a little bit of a difference in your performance, as in because you
Oh,
were
yeah.
bigger before? Did you find the bumps were a little bit harder, or did you just throw yourself
So
into them harder?
I actually throw myself into them harder now, but it was a bit of a shock when, because I've lost, I think we're at 9 stone total now. So I mean, there's a big change from where we started to where I am now, and with that there's a lot of physical changes that go on. Suddenly you do feel everything a bit more, because there's suddenly less fat there to protect your bones. So you do feel everything a bit more. But I'm a bit of a sadist. I kind of like that. I'm like, yeah, this is excellent. Hit me. Go for it. Let's go. Bumps. Yeah, let's go harder. Oh, I'm gonna throw myself off something. Cool. Close your eyes. Let's go. But for my actual wrestling, I had to, and I'm still very much in the process of finding out how my new body works. There's stuff that I just was not capable of doing when I was heavier. Given the my condition as well, with the fibromyalgia, being heavier was making that condition harder to deal with and making it worse, which then also put a load of physical barriers in the way. So there was stuff that I just, before the pandemic, before losing the weight and before getting fitter, it just wasn't possible for me. Whereas now I'm launching myself off ropes, I'm doing scarier things, I'm trying bigger things, I can run about to my heart's content. And I think that it's really challenged me to think about the way that I wrestle and the way that I have to work now, because obviously when you're bigger, there's a very sort of me big, me throw you about. That was generally what I went for before. If anyone asked me what my wrestling style was before, it was, I'm a brawler who grabs people and throws them about because I can. And now I'm very much in like a sort of middle weight division, where there's a whole bunch of people smaller than me and there's a whole bunch of people bigger than me, and that requires a whole lot more thought. So it very much made me look at how I'm moving about, how I'm wrestling, how I look at different opponents, and how I have to then strategize a lot more to be able to get the same result as I would have gotten from grab and smash.
Yeah, so yeah, you've now you were put into a box beforehand, and now you've got, oh, there's other boxes I can do now. So
Yes.
let's try
Yeah,
death match
exactly.
kind of thing. That's, so yeah, this, which again, another subject we should get onto during this chat.
Yes.
So during that time, was this when you're kind of into the looking sharp? Was it the online dojo? Because I heard you mention CVs. I know that was a big thing that Lou
Yes.
had instilled on everyone who came within contact with the looking sharp
Yeah.
dojo. So is that your way of keeping, when you were still working during the pandemic, was that your way of keeping on top of the wrestling, with the
Yeah.
theory, I suppose, through the
Yeah. The seminars that we did with LKS, which, by the way, if anyone who is training for wrestling is interested, you can actually buy them from Lou himself. He saved them all. They're a great resource. It's something that I still dip back into once in a while, if I'm wanting to refresh my memory on certain ones. Like there was one we did with Hector Guerrero that was fantastic, but there was so much information in it. It was just not possible to get everything down the first watch. So thankfully I've been able to sort of rewatch those ones. But it was a great tool during the pandemic, because obviously we couldn't actually go out and network. You can't, all of our interactions were online because everybody was so separate. So having that there and being able to speak to these people that I would normally never have had access to, like normally just wrestling about the Scottish scene, I'm not going to bump into Hector Guerrero or oh, who else did we have? My brain's just gone blank. Or
Mikey Whipwreck, that was one of them, I think.
Mikey Whipwreck, and my words are not working today. Or we also had Selena De La Renta as well, and I would never have had the chance to speak to these people and pick their brain and be like, what do you think's like the most important thing in wrestling right now, or what do you think people need to focus on? Or for myself, like especially anytime we got a woman on, it would be, what's the best advice for women in wrestling? Like, how do you think I should proceed with this or that? And it was a great resource. And it was also a great way of keeping in touch with other wrestlers during the whole thing. There were so many different people from different countries all participated. We were all encouraged to discuss and talk. And it was a really good resource to have during that time.
Yeah, I mean, I somehow found myself on one of them, and it was the Krieger tag team one. So that was just for my own interest. I wanted to see what it was about. And you're right, it is. It was just such a vast amount of information, stuff you don't think about at the time. And now, even as a fan, I'm watching tag team matches, and now I'm going, oh, that's that little thing that Krieger said. That's that there. That's that thing as well. There was just so much. There was so much theory involved. I mean, of course, there would be a bit of like how to do this a little bit better, but yeah, there was so much how match structures worked, and it was fascinating to watch from my side of the barrier, but let alone for someone who's going to be taking it and putting it into practice as well.
Like, we focus so much within ring training on the physical side of things that it was good to sort of take that out the equation. And then you suddenly had to think about everything else that's involved with wrestling, every other bit and piece and bit of psychology that's involved, which, like, again, silver linings. I think it made all of us really appreciate the other things that involved, not just the physical aspects, because obviously you're only getting like a few hours in a training session each time during a week, and you've got X amount of people. So usually it's focused on like matches and the physical aspects, making sure that we're keeping each other safe. And not that we don't focus on the other bits, but it was just really good to sort of specifically be like, right, we're removing the physical element here. Really think about wrestling, really think about the storytelling, really think about the psychology behind what you're doing. And I think because that challenged us all, we've all come out of the other side of this with a much better sort of mental understanding of what we're all doing, what we're all trying to achieve.
Have you found out that, are you able to switch off while you watch wrestling now, or is that,
oh,
now
God, no.
You've done that, you've instilled it in your brain, you're going, right, what's that footwork like? Is wrestling now, for whether it's WWE, AEW, when you're watching it live, is it all just now cogs going, watching, learning as you go?
All the time. So I'm very, I like to watch wrestling with other people. I'm a very social person when it comes to my wrestling, so I like to sit there and discuss it with whoever I'm watching it with. And I've never seen, but since I started training, I've never been able to watch wrestling again without going, how did he do that? Why did he do that? Why was his positioning like that? All right, I get why that was that. I understand that now. It's literally, I love it. I still love the storylines and I love watching it, but I cannot sit and watch it now without looking at it from a dual perspective. So you've got the fan part of me being like, oh, this is awesome. I just love wrestling. And then you've got the other part of me who will sit and dissect everything and be like, right, what can I take from this? How can I improve on that? How could I use that and turn it into my own way? How would I do that? I think it gets annoying sometimes for people if I'm sitting there, because I will literally just, I'm an out loud processor. I have ADHD. I say everything out loud to be able to make my brain understand it. So I think it can get frustrating for people sometimes when I'm sitting there like rewinding it, going, how did he do that? That's a great Canadian destroyer. Exactly how did he land that? How did he run into that? Where was the position on that? It's like, sorry, man, you're just going to have to deal with it. This is my way.
That when you say that makes our, well, we sat together for one of the matches at Community Pro in Peterhead, which makes it all the funnier for me, because I'm very much, I have to concentrate and focus, because I'll just, my mind will wander otherwise. So you were sitting next to me talking about it, and you must have thought I was the right dick.
No, I was, not at all.
I was just sitting there just going, watching. I was trying to interact, but if I stopped looking, my mind would just go away.
You are totally fine. I did not think you were a dick at all. I'm just one of those people, because I like to think of my ADHD as a superpower.
Mm-hmm.
I can concentrate in about 4 or 5 different things going on all at the same time and then still hold a conversation about what's going on with them all. I've been told it's quite overwhelming for people sometimes if I'm sitting there with, like, there's something on here, there's wrestling on there, I'm concentrating on this, and they're doing something, I'm trying to talk about all three things that I'm doing while they're trying to do something. Totally get that's like stressful. I once actually had a manager quit one of my shoot jobs because apparently I talked too much. She told me this before she left.
See, I wish I had that skill because I have to have subtitles on when I watch things now because I can't focus on the sound and the vision at the same time. So I think I'm just, yeah, I think I'm putting it down to age or just I'm so introverted that I'm now inside out with watching things.
Yes.
But no, it's something I wish I had the skill to do because yeah, I've just don't. And like I was saying, I felt like maybe I looked like a bit of a dick in that situation because when you see shows that people are going mad at, and I'm just in the corner with my arms crossed watching, it's going, yeah, that's really exciting. But if I take my mind away, then I have to reset it again to get back into the moment. So it's just, yeah,
To be fair,
brains are
you have a
annoying.
job to do. You have to actually like pay attention to exactly what's going on. You're reviewing everything. So like it's totally understandable that you need to be the one guy being like, no, I'm focused on what's happening.
I know. Sorry, I just my brain just went job.
Yes.
But yeah, I'm doing it now because I'm trying to write a review of a show I went to this past Saturday in Inverurie, and I did their podcast about it. I did stuff like that, and I'm sitting there going, "Oh, I concentrated on everything else. I can't remember what actually happened now, and it's 5 days removed. So that's the next couple of days of me staring at a computer screen while I go, what happened?
You should
This happened."
get a wee dictaphone app on your phone, just every so often, just into the dictaphone, and then that way you don't have to remember too much.
I was mad for like William Shatner just going, headbutt. Bounce. There,
Discuss.
there. Anyway, we've gone off from there. So when you came back, of course, Respect Pro had their big comeback shows and we spoke about it. And then they closed, was it May? Something like that, May time,
Me, yeah.
May 2022. What were your thoughts? Because that was your kind of home promotion, I would say, Respect. So when that was coming to an end, were you kind of a little bit lost, or had you already kind of built a rapport with other promotions, so you knew that you had places to go? What was your kind of thoughts
So
on that?
I was in quite a lucky position that I'm on good terms with quite a few different promotions that have got training schools. At the time, Luking Sharp was actually one of our coaches at Respect. He had been for I think nearly a year, sort of like online, and then when we finally did do physical classes again. And when Respect started to sort of wind down and we knew that it was all coming to an end, that's when the LKS Dojo started up, like in a physical capacity. We got a training space, and I was really lucky that I just transitioned from going from Respect to the LKS Dojo. But it did offer me an opportunity because I suddenly didn't have the same place to drive 5 minutes down the road and train 6 times a week. It did sort of offer me an opportunity to explore a wee bit and try classes at a few different places, try and sort of get a bit more of a diverse, I don't know how I put that, like a diverse set of opinions on wrestling as well, because wrestling's one of those things, everybody's got an opinion and everybody's opinion's slightly different. And I like to try and get all those different opinions and see where I settle within sort of the sort of greater opinion, if that makes sense. I'm not really a big follower of exactly what anyone else is doing, so it's been good to have the sort of opportunity to go to different places, visit places like the CPN school or Iron Girders, and see what they're teaching and see what wealth of experience their coaches have got, as well as attending the LKS Dojo.
Found once the pandemic lifted and everything, the doors kind of went wide open for schools because they were trying to obviously try to get people back in. But there would have been a sense of pre-pandemic of if you train here, you can't train here, or you have to train here only and you can't do anything else. But when it came back, it seemed to be just come, come
I
do some
think
wrestling.
everybody was just so happy to wrestle again that we're like, just everybody just do it. Just go somewhere, just do it. That's one of the, obviously, with the pandemic being such an awful thing and so many people suffering, it's difficult to sit and go, well, there were positives to it. But I'm always a silver linings type of person. I always try and find the sort of silver lining in any situation. Like we were joking about the break-in situation earlier. Well, the people have broke my window, so now it doesn't open in or out. So it's actually more secure than it was in the first place. Silver lining. I mean, it's still broken, but you know, nobody's getting open. But yeah, so looking for like the silver linings, it seems to have just, like you said, opened everything up. There's less of a sort of territorial thing going on. Mm-hmm. There's less of that. Like you said, if you train here, you can't go there. If you train here, you can't go there. And it's more, everybody's working together now, and there's a big, I would say, like, community feeling amongst a lot of the wrestlers now. There's not that big divide. People are working for a lot more companies and intermingling a lot more. And it's really nice to see, because it's taken some of that negative energy that could have been there before, that was being sort of put in place by, oh, we've got to keep everything separate. This is our lot, that's your lot. And everybody's just a lot happier now. It's one of the sort of few positive things I think came out of the pandemic, was that we seem to have a much greater sense of community now within the actual wrestlers.
Absolutely. I mean, obviously there's still promotions out there that you don't want to do, but they kind of, they're all now in a cluster on their own, and they just do their own thing. They've got their own kind of people that they use, and one might come out of the pond for a second and then go back to where they're safe. So it's just, like you say, it's a bit more harmonious.
Exactly.
If you don't like them, you just ignore them. That's kind of how it's gone now, which, you know,
works for me.
As good as you could probably get it without. I was about to make a really shitty comment about something else, so I'll leave it. I'll edit myself.
Yes, without making it any worse.
Exactly. We'll move on. No councils involved. Right. Okay. So respectable gone. Your safety net's kind of still there with the Looking Sharp Dojo. But from there, of course, we know Lou. He's got this network of mobile wrestlers. Is that when you started finding out about going to Europe, or had you already done that pre-Dojo?
So there had been, I had an international booking actually scheduled for January 2022, but due to the sort of resurgence in COVID at the time, it got cancelled. And it wasn't until March that year that I did my first booking in Denmark. That all did come about through Lou, and it was sort of during that period we found out that Respect was going to be shutting. I think it was at the beginning of March, and then obviously everything wound down towards May. So there was a bit of a transition period where Lou sort of started taking over with the training and stuff, and with that came the opportunities to do more international bookings and to get more international networking done as well. So it had originally come about, I was really hoping to go to Italy in January last year, but it wasn't to be. Hoping to still get out there, still keeping good communication with the company. But it wasn't till the March of 2022 when I got the first one, which turned out to be a very interesting and very, I'll say, explosive debut for Denmark.
Yes, I have it written down. I was wondering if it was the same one, but now you said that, it has to be. So March 2022 debut, was it Dangst? Was it Dangst Pro Wrestling, or was it?
No, it was CCW.
It was Copenhagen, excellent. Against Lexi Luxx, am I right in thinking that?
Yes.
Right, okay. So we've had Lexi on the show before, and lovely, absolutely lovely guest. But there was always, she'd went on quite a bit about wanting to do things like death matches, hardcore matches, and stuff like that. And I saw the pictures of this particular match with you and Lexi. I think, did she get a broken nose? Someone got a broken nose, isn't it?
Lexi does like to point out very regularly how badly I smashed her nose into her face. But yes, that was that match.
So approaching it then, of course, you've already said that you've threw yourself harder into everything when shows came back. Was the idea anything hardcore match, or was it just that's how it evolved into and you just went for it? What was the whole thing?
The opportunity was presented to me and I threw myself at it. I had never, when I was younger, I was never the kid who was watching like deathmatch wrestling and being like, yeah, more blood, yeah. But I did enjoy touches of it within WWE, and it was something that I'd looked at a little bit. But when the opportunity to actually do it came up, I was like, do you know what? Yeah. The only way you're getting more opportunities is by saying, yeah, and I can do this, so let's do it. And it was a lot of fun. It was a very steep learning curve, and you probably shouldn't take your first proper kendo shot in a match. That sucked because I had no idea what I was going to be expecting. I just went, yeah, sure, you're hitting me. Yep, cool, right, no bother. And then when the first one landed, I was like, oh, that's what that feels like. Cool, right, let's keep going. Let's move. But it was never something that I had massively planned to do. But I'm really glad that I got the opportunity to do it, and I'm very interested in doing more. I just have to work out what I'm comfortable taking, and then we'll go from there.
Say, is that the first time you've bled in a match as well?
I didn't actually bleed in that match.
It was her blood that was on you.
That was her blood. So I might have there might have been a small bit of that match after breaking Lexi's nose and bursting her open. I might have slapped her in the face and went and painted her blood all over my face. A bit of a war paint thing, kind of a, oh, you think you've got this, douche. But yes, no, I came out of that match covered in finger paint blood, and Lexi came out looking like I had killed her. But do you know what? One thing I will say for that lassie, I hit her square in the face with a chair. I mean, like, I hit her and she took it like a champ. I don't know many people that could get smashed right in the nose like that and just take it. I was genuinely impressed. I obviously, after it, you want to make sure everybody's okay. Does anybody need to go to the hospital? That kind of thing. But I remember she looking up, making sure she was cool, shaking her hand after it, being like, thank you very much for that. I had a lot of fun. Fuck me, you're hard. Let's do that again. I enjoyed that. I was like, if you're up for it, I'm up for it.
That's, yeah, like I said, from that conversation we had with her way back when, that's kind of vibe we got from her. And I just couldn't believe it. Not that I couldn't believe it, but it was just like, wow, they've went all in on it. So you mentioned the kendo stick, you mentioned the chair. Was there anything that you had in that match that you went, yeah, I'm not having that again? Or is there anything that you had and went, that wasn't so bad, maybe I can do something a bit more with it in the future? Like, I don't know, was drawing pins involved? Because we're in UK,
yes.
Drawing pins.
Yes, there were drawing pins involved. I actually didn't mind the drawing pins, although I did get one stuck in my shin that I didn't realise was there until like 10, 20 minutes after the match. Because, you know, the adrenaline's going and you're just like, you're way up here after it. And about 20 minutes later, I looked down and realised there was a thumbtack stuck into my shin through my trousers. I was like, oh, okay. Pulled it out and then went, oh, that hurts. I didn't realise that hurt. But I would definitely do them again. There was nothing in the match that I was like, oh, I'm definitely never doing that again. I think the only thing in deathmatch wrestling that really gives me the fear is light tubes. Light tubes and glass. It's like the only thing. It sounds so, because it's one of those staple things, but I've always been paranoid about getting glass in my eye. It's a weird fear that I've had for a very long time. I don't know why, but I've just had this big thing. Anytime a glass smashes, my first reaction is to close my eyes because I'm just like, it's going to my eye. It's going to my eye. That's what's happening. So it's the only thing that I'm like, do you want to bring barbed wire in? Cool, let's do that. Oh, we're gonna hit each other with chairs. Cool, no problem. We're going to throw each other into tables even. Yeah, that's great. Just don't hit me with a light tube.
There you go. There's the only line. Mine is for watching carpet grippers.
Oh yeah, I can imagine that stings.
Yeah, I mean, again, I would never do any of that stuff. But I'm quite happy with where I am, in my seat here. But yeah, as soon as I see carpet grippers get involved, I'm like, no, no.
There's a slight part of me that thinks that growing up with hundreds of brothers who all liked wrestling when we were younger has given me less fear of these things. Because there are many occasions where my mum would have to tell us to put down whatever random thing we tried to hit each other with down. There was the incident with the sledgehammer where I was told I had to put it down. I wasn't actually going to hit my brother with it. I was just threatening with it. But, you know. But there was a time where my mum decided to re-carpet the entire house and thought it'd be a great idea to leave all of the stuff sitting in the hall. So, of course, me and two of my brothers thought the best thing would just be pick things up and hit each other with them. Thankfully, though, we didn't get the spiky ends. We were hitting each other with like the flat end of them, just clipping each other. But you know, if somebody pitches it in a match, yeah, let's do it. Why not?
Right, but better you than me. I'll just, yeah, like I say, I'll stay at this end of things. So from that point onwards, though, I was looking at the, well, that was the year after, so I'll come back to that. It was March 2023 was in our match, so I've got my notes. But so that was your first trip to Europe. At that point, you're kind of working through a little bit of the women's wrestlers that are in Scotland. So you've had a couple matches here and there. So was there anyone pre-pandemic that you had your eye on that you're able to get when you came back?
So in Scotland, there was a couple of girls that I really wanted to wrestle, Ellie Armstrong being one of them. Ellie is one of my favourite people at the moment to wrestle in Scotland. She's a lot of fun. Whether we hate each other, love each other at the time, we still have an excellent match. It's always good fun, and I were battering each other, but like honestly, she was one that I had my eye on from beforehand, who I've been really lucky to wrestle a few times now, including one where Ellie was a pumpkin.
Mm-hmm.
That was interesting. I was covered in orange fuzz for days. I swear I went for a shower and I still found orange fuzz, and I'm like, how, where is this coming from? But she was one that I really had my eye on. Outside of Scotland, Aliss was someone that I'd had my eye on for a really long time. She seems larger than life until you actually meet her. Like, she's this ninja looking, tattooed, scary MMA martial arts trained woman. And when I finally got to wrestle her, it was amazing. I loved it so much. I learned so much from her just in the sort of process of it all. And thankfully I've actually had a couple of chances to wrestle her now, and each time it just gets better and better. There's quite a few people in Scotland though that haven't wrestled yet that I've got my eye on. I would love to wrestle Molly Spartan. Molly Spartan is, because she was one of the people when I was going more down the brawler, throw people about route, she was one of the people that I was watching and being like, oh, I want to do that. I want to carry myself like that. I want to command the same kind of presence when I walk into a ring as Molly Spartan does. So if I could get the opportunity to wrestle her, that would be fantastic. That's actually on the goal list for the next year, as I'm trying to make this happen. Her and Casey, actually, both of them. Just bring on, two at the one time, just beat me up. Let's go.
Just a handicap, or would you want to at least have someone with you? Or would that be a sharing?
No, just me. I'm not sharing. I'm a greedy, greedy bam. Like, no, nah, all for me.
Fair enough. So one of them came up, we're jumping all over the place here, but we've got April 2023, you were down in Newcastle and you've got Lana Austin for wrestling Newcastle. So as far as opponents go at that point, so that's April, that's probably one of the most high-profile opponents you would have had at the time. So do you feel the pressure when it comes to going in the ring with someone with a reputation like Lana Austin, or do you just approach a match the same way as you do any other?
I approach it the same way. Because every match, I don't ever want to go out there and feel like I'm phoning it in, like ever. I feel that, especially when people are paying for tickets to come see us do what we do, I don't ever want to walk out there and just like, I'll just do this, I'll just do that, and then we'll go. Every single match that I've got, I really want to put thought and effort and preparation and make sure that I'm giving the best that I can give. So I approach it the same way. Well, shite myself. I walked in and I remember I was raging actually, because that weekend I had been ill. I had been really unwell on the lead up to the match, and I was doing everything that I could, like borderline contacting a witch for spells type, doing everything that I could, like, what's this remedy? What's an actual thing for this? What can I smell or drink or anything to make this better? So when I got there was a kind of extra layer of, oh, not only am I wrestling Lana Austin, but I'm not at my best right now. This needs to be good. And I walked in and she was really nice. Straight away, it was just like down to business. Just one of the best experiences I've sort of had walking in, not knowing the person beforehand. And I've obviously known who Lana was for a really long time. So I was really nervous. And she was like, don't be nervous. So this is what we do. Like, I'm just another person. Like, this is just match. Let's do what we do. And it was a great experience. I loved every minute of it. Even taking that rolling forearm off. Like, I thought for a set, I'm lying there going, am I knocked out? No, I'm not knocked out. That felt great. Before, you know, having to be helped backstage. But yeah, no, I loved every minute of it. It was just great. I was shaking like a leaf right before I went out the curtain though. Because even at this stage, I still, every time you go out, there's like a little bit of nervousness. Because if you're not nervous, you don't care enough, is what I was always told anyway. But on that occasion, there was the, oh, my legs feel like jelly, I've got butterflies in my stomach, but this is going to be good. And then once I was out the curtain, it all settled down. I went out, did the thing, and it was fine. But I was definitely a lot more nervous for that match than I have been for some other ones, just because, I mean, it's Lana freaking Austin.
Well, that's it. As name popped up, I was like, as soon as I saw it, it's like, yeah, that's a pretty big deal. I mean, the month before, you would have had your match with Regina Rosendahl, who
yes,
a pioneer in Finnish pro wrestling. And she came over to the UK for a little bit as well. Yeah. So a little bit of a different kettle of fish, I suppose, because Regina, though, is big in Europe, she's probably not as well known as a name in the UK as much. But
yeah,
still, that's still a pretty big match to have on your CV.
That was actually the first match that I bled in, was the match against Regina, because right at the end of the match, I take a belt shot to the face. And I was actually so gutted. That match went great. I enjoyed that so much. And we had the belt shot at the end. And you can barely see the blood because the house lights are so bright and I'm so pale. That it's actually, my skin is almost like Twilight Vampire shiny. Like, I look, it's just like white irradiating out through and you can't see the blood hardly at all. By the time I got backstage, I was covered in it. Thankfully, glad I picked the red gear because, you know, blood won't stain red. But I was covered in blood and I was like, just so gutted that you couldn't see it on the footage. Because it was like, the first time I've done this, and it looked impressive in person, and then it looked so washed out in the footage. I was just so gutted about it.
Is that the thing that kind of overrode your thought of, I'm bleeding, I'm covered in blood? Was it more just the anger of going, but nobody saw it, so does it count, kind of thing?
A little bit, yeah. There was also, there was a moment when the blood sort of started flowing down my forehead that I went, huh, I've never cut my head open before. I didn't know what this was going to feel like. That feels gross. Like, and it was just, and it was, do you know that way? I'm sitting there, I'm lying on the ground, I'm being pulled up in my hair and stuff, and there's blood streaming down my face, and all I can think is, God, that feels weird. I didn't think it was going to, why is it warm? Well, that makes sense. Of course it's warm. It's blood drift, everybody even. But yeah, you know what I mean? Like, it was just such a bizarre, you would think you'd be concerned about the fact there was blood coming out your head, and all I could think is, that feels so strange. Why didn't I think about how strange this would feel?
I mean, if it's not done on, if you're not expecting it as well, it is just the initial thought of just going, oh. So, I mean, next time, if the plan is to get blood or anything like that, you'll probably be a bit more like, oh no, this might hurt to get. But yeah, if it just happens, you're like, oh, well.
I find adrenaline really, really helps with that kind of thing. There's occasions where I'll, like, not obviously with blood and stuff, but there'll be occasions where, say, I'll try to do something in training and I am like, I'm terrified of heights. I'm like really, really scared of heights. I always have been. And I'm currently trying to force myself to launch myself off the top rope as much as possible to get over the fear of heights. And I found that in training, I'm a lot more aware of how scared I am of it and how my body feels and being very aware of it. Whereas when you're in a match and the adrenaline's going and you've been running about and there's an entire crowd sitting there looking at you, there's that element of the adrenaline's going, you're not as scared because that's happening and you're more willing to do it. But then also, I really just have a massive thing about not looking like a wimp. So if there's an entire audience of people there, I'm going to do it because I'm not a wimp. I think it stems from the whole having hundreds of brothers thing. I'm like, no, I will not be seen to be scared up here. I will climb up here and I will throw myself and it will be fine.
I can absolutely sympathize. Not the loads of brothers thing, but the thought of that, because this is going to sound really weedy in comparison, but at Landmark up in Carbridge, they've got this big thing that you climb up. It's about, I don't know, in my brain when I looked down, it was 100 meters, but it's probably like 25. And it, like, my mate was just being an absolute bitch about jumping down. So I was like, I'll do it. I'll do it. And I was just about to jump. My knees just went, no, you're not. And just like buckled underneath me. And I was like, oh, this is embarrassing. My brain
It's
said
when your
yes, my body
body's
went
like,
no.
it's always my brain sitting going, right, go, on you go, come on, you've done this before, move. And my body's just like, no, I'm not doing that. I'm not moving. I'm not moving no matter what you do. I actually have quite a few clips of training that I've sort of, they're just clips that I sort of keep for myself so I can look back on and see how I'm progressing and stuff. But there's been multiple ones I've looked back on where I've tried to do things like attempting a suicide dive out the ring, things like that, where you can see me run up and try and physically make myself jump, and my body just goes, no. Like, literally, I'll just stop dead, and my whole body's just gone, no. And I've had to try about, I think it was about five times before my body would let me actually jump out the ring. Like, I got all tangled up in the ropes at one point because I went to do it. Tried to force myself and then had like a weird moment where my body and my head were just arguing with each other, so I got tied up in the ropes, which was hilarious to watch back, to be fair.
We start a wee support group because I was speaking to Daisy Jenkins at the start of the week for an episode that'll come out 2 weeks before this one, and she's got the same goal as trying to jump off top rope by the end of, well, by the end of the year. So, you know, there could be a top rope support group maybe that everyone can encourage each other and try and make it happen.
I've said to her, I've actually, I spoke to Daisy quite recently, and I have said to her, I was like, we will do this. We will beat this. We are wee women and we will do this.
I tell you, when I see a match, if I see a match announced before the end of the year, Daisy Jenkins, Rubi Roberts, is like, well, someone's going off the top rope in that one, whether they want to or not. It will happen.
Well, there is actually a match coming up on the 1st of October in the Opry in Glasgow where it'll be myself, Sammy Jane, and Daisy. So, yeah, more than likely you're going to see some of that. Although I don't want to give too much away, people should still buy tickets because it's going to be mental. But yeah.
To be honest, if they haven't got tickets by now, they're way too late. Because this will be
Yeah.
on the 13th, but those shows
Oh,
are
yeah.
looking they're looking really good though. The Copenhagen shows that Lou's doing over here, there seems to be some just an absolute array of matches and characters that you'll see on those shows.
Yeah.
When he when well, we'll just move on to that then, because he's of course you're quite involved with helping out at those shows and being on the shows as well
Yes.
for Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. So they're being taped for TV as well in Denmark. So would that be kind of the first time you're kind of working towards a camera or being conscious of it being recorded, or has that ever been something that's been a bother for you?
It's something that I'm still very much getting into the way of, with sort of with standard family show wrestling. It's usually filmed, but you have like a hard cam and you'll have your roaming cam, and obviously you have to be aware of where those are and what's happening with them. But there's a bit less of an emphasis put on finding the camera and playing to the camera as well as the crowd. So this has been a really good learning experience, really sort of bridging the gap between indie wrestling for myself and then TV style wrestling, where you're not just playing to the crowd and to the parents and kids right in front of you. You've also got to keep in mind constantly that you've got to show out to that camera as well. Be aware of where your angles are. Where should you set things up? Where do you need to be looking at what point? It's been really, really interesting to sort of go through that and learn on the job with CCW as far as that's concerned. And it's been really good as well because they have so many people coming from so many different places that you get all this sort of wealth of knowledge about all the different types of wrestling that everyone else has experienced. That it's been a really interesting experience learning. I'm going in circles now, but like learning how to do that, because it's not something that's focused on as much within the sort of more indie family show scene.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you consider in the match that will take place, will have taken place by the time that, this episode goes out. And you've got Daisy, of course, who did the ICW tapings, so would have had mm-hmm. that experience. That was how she yes. got started. Anyway, it was debut was in front of a hard yeah. camp. And then you've got Emerson Jane, who's wrestled everywhere. So clearly, yes. we'll I would like to think by now knows how to work towards a camera. So if there's any match to have that kind of experience be enhanced, then surely that's mm-hmm. going to be a match that people will enjoy yeah. themselves, but one that's certainly going to be a great learning experience for yourself, considering
yes, your definitely. Definitely. It's an interesting one for myself as well. Daisy and I have wrestled a few times, 3 times I think now, for CCW. It's been a very back and forth, I don't know how to put this. It's been a very interesting back and forth relationship. We are, I love Daisy, but when we get in that ring, it is a case of we are trying to kick the crap out of each other. We want to deliver a good match, but then there's also this rivalry that's sort of come up through it where I'm like, oh, you rolled me up last time. That is not happening again.
Mm-hmm.
And then you introduce someone like Emerson into that equation as well, who I've, again, followed for years. I've known about her for so long, following when she went to Japan and everything else. I don't know what to expect from this match, other than I think that I'm going to have a great time doing it, but I think it's going to be one of the best ones that I have been part of so far. I've got a lot of high expectations for this match.
Well, if anyone's listening now, it's happened. I'm sure it was amazing. That's pretty much it. Keep yes. an eye on Copenhagen Championship Wrestling as well. But like I say, you're involved with it. I'm always seeing posts on your Instagram or your social mm-hmm. media about flyering and going out and making sure that everyone knows about the shows. Is that something that yeah. that's always been instilled with you when you started training, that if people don't buy tickets, then there's no point in us doing it, kind of thing? And you're always
yeah
wanting to be part, wanting to help as much as you possibly can. Is that something you've yeah focused on?
Yeah. With respect, it was always something that I wanted to participate in highly. Like, I love wrestling, but I don't just love watching it and I don't just love doing it. It's like every aspect of what we do is part of this job. There's an element of, yes, we need bums in seats. So at the end of the day, that's not going to happen by magic. It's not going to happen just because we've posted it in one place. It requires a lot of hard work on the company's part, the wrestler's part, anyone who's going out to poster in the piss and rain or stand outside a shopping centre handing out flyers. But it's also something that I really enjoy because it gives you a chance to talk to the people who would actually be coming to the shows, or it gives you a chance to convert someone who's maybe never watched wrestling as an adult, or a wee granny who hasn't seen it since Giant Haystacks was on the telly and they were watching Hulk Hogan back in the old days with like World of Sport and all of that. It gives you a chance to really humanize wrestlers as well. Like, they see that we're people and you get that conversation going and you can get somebody interested and bring them to a show, and suddenly it's unlocked some sort of deep hidden love for wrestling that they forgot they had. And it's really good to be able to interact with fans and people who are interested in the shows that way. Because as a wrestler, it also gives me like more of a relationship with them, but it also gives me more of an idea of what they're looking for. So it's almost like, it's like part and part. It's like part I get to interact with the people that are actually coming to the shows and boost the shows and put in the hard work to make sure that we've got bums in seats. But then it's also a bit like market research for me, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Actually getting to speak to parents and find out what their objections are to coming to wrestling shows or why they wouldn't want to spend that money helps me sort of develop what I'm doing, help people round about me, make suggestions for shows. It's all part of the process for me, and me personally, I just love it. I'm always volunteering to do these things because if you're getting right in people's faces, it gives you that opportunity to actually sell to them directly rather than me just posting it online and being like, hey guys, buy a ticket, here's a show. If I'm actually getting the chance to get into people's faces, then I'm more likely to strike a conversation and, like I said, humanise wrestlers as well. Like, because even though we all go out there dressed in spandex like superheroes and kick the crap out of each other for an indeterminate amount of time, we are still people, and I think that it's good to be able to sort of put that across as well and really get them interested in the wrestlers as people and not just random performers like it's a panto.
And it's also using that energy that you have, that passionate energy that you quote unquote things that annoys people, but you're able to put it into sell mode or into being able to, because if people speak to you and realize how passionate you are about this thing, then that makes people more intrigued going off. If she's that passionate about this, I'll be as well try it at least.
Yeah.
Just go have a look.
And you know what? It gives me an opportunity to try and find people who might want to try wrestling as well. Because I'm forever trying to pitch wrestling to people as an alternative fitness thing. Because you know what? It's not the performance side of things isn't always for everybody. It's not always, not everybody, like I said, wants to dress up in spandex pants and throw themselves about in front of a crowd of people. But it's something that I've found so rewarding from a fitness point of view as well, that I'm forever trying to say to people, do you know what? You should just give it a go. Just even if you don't like it, just try it once and see if you like it. Because if you find out it's your thing, it's a great way to have a community of people around about you that are really supportive, exercise in like an alternative way that isn't just running a treadmill or going at the gym and lifting weights. It's weird and it's diverse and it attracts so many different kinds of people that I'm forever just saying to people, like, do you know what? Might not be interesting coming to see a show, but would you be interested in giving it a try? Because you never know.
Exactly. So we'll dive into the questions because I noticed that we're time is running away with us today. And we've got loads of questions. So we've got Scott coming in first. He's got quite a few, one through Twitter, one through DMs. I think I'm just going to read it for verbatim. He said, I just want to know why she doesn't understand.
So Scott is quite a good friend of mine, and that is an inside.
My internet dropped there. Hello. That's fine.
Oh, thank God. I thought the question killed the internet.
No.
Oh.
Well, thankfully, it was when we just started the question. So that means I can edit it a little bit better, hopefully.
Okay.
So I'll just restart that bit. Okay. So got some questions on Instagram. No, I didn't. We did. But I've panicked because of internet difficulties. So we've got questions on Twitter. Let's get it back up. It'll be fine. It'll be edited. I'm telling myself this. I don't know if it actually will be. So Scott has asked, I just want to know why she doesn't understand. He's asked verbatim. I just want to know why she doesn't. Fuck, I've ruined this.
It's so hard to say. No, I know exactly what you're.
I did it right the first time. That's the most annoying bit.
The reason I just don't understand is a private joke. Scott is a very good friend of mine. And I don't understand because I'm still learning, and that's all I'll say.
Fair enough. Right. Because I got it right the first time, I'm going to try and chop it a little bit so I don't look like such an idiot. Be fine.
Get you saying it and then just chop it off before I answer it. And just put that in.
I like using the SpongeBob SquarePants a few moments later, I've got technical difficulties thing. I'll throw that in. I'll be fine. Right. I hate the internet. Right. Okay. Moving on. We've got more questions from Scott through the private DMs. So, which are a little bit more, I think one's still an inside joke, which is, do you fear Cheeks the Butcher?
I do not fear Cheeks the Butcher, but one day I look forward to wrestling Cheeks the Butcher. I've told him that he needs to get his wrestling boots on, that he needs to get his ass into training so that I can get a fight with him.
So it's coming soon. Cheeks the Butcher versus Rubi Roberts.
Yes.
And for one social outcast or weirdo, as we call it, now that you've found your people and your path in life, what would you tell child Rubi that's still trying to discover who she is?
Oh, that's a big one.
You set it up with the silly questions to throw in that one.
Yeah, that's a really good question. So, that's a really good question. So, what I would say to little Ruby is just be patient. I was so impatient when I was younger because, I mean, for good reasons, I was bullied extensively as a child, like really badly as a child. Like, I was that kid at school that, like, every kid in the school made fun of. So I was, when I got out of school, I was so impatient to start my life and find my people. And it took a while. Now that I've found wrestling, and I mean, I really have found my weirdos in wrestling. Just some friends in wrestling that I know for a fact that I'll be friends with for the rest of my life. I think I would tell Ruby, younger Ruby, to be patient. It will happen. You will get the matches that you want to get. You will become the fantastic blue-haired weirdo you always wanted to be. Especially when I was younger, I listened to a lot of other people. I listened to people tell me that I was too loud, that I was too big, that I was too in people's faces all the time. And I was told that if I wanted to fit in, if I wanted to have a normal job, all these things, that I would have to squeeze myself into this tiny wee box, this wee neat, tidy box that I just didn't fit in. And I finally got to a place where I realised that I wasn't meant to fit in that box, but it was all through wrestling and finding those people. So yeah, just be patient. It will happen. Just stay the course, keep working hard, and it will happen.
And we'll finish up the Twitter section before I go into the Instagram questions with James Blair, old school fool, with a question. His only question is, and he's done it in capitals, so just imagine I'm shouting it. Where can Old School Cool buy one of her retro t-shirts?
Oh, well, you can get one of these retro style handmade t-shirts from myself. I am currently making them myself. So if you send me a wee DM on Twitter, Instagram or Facebook, we'll get it organised and I'll get one sent out to you with a wee personalised signed photo. Also, I think the reason that OSC James Blair is constantly in caps is because I think he's just deaf. I think he's just an old 80s style deaf man wrestler at this point. I think it's all just coming out because he is shouting everything. Like, I imagine it like a wee old man shouting in my head.
He set caps lock on at some point on his phone and he
doesn't know how to fix it.
Yeah. We've all been there. So back to Instagram then. So we've got quite a few questions. Judas Gray, he just likes himself getting mentioned on episodes now, so he just puts in loads of questions, which is great. Mm-hmm. It works for everyone. But we'll start with Yanislavic one, who's just put a statement. He's put, best female wrestler in Scotland.
Oh, I really appreciate that. I love that Slavic man. He is fantastic, and I'm really hoping we get to wrestle at some point, because I'm forever saying, like, I don't care if you're man, woman, child, he, she, they, or toaster, I want to wrestle you, and he's one of those people.
I thought maybe you meant to put a question mark at the end of it, but no, it's definitely going with the statement.
We'll just decide it's a statement.
That's it. We've got Robbie Wishart asking, do you know the Muffin Man?
The Muffin Man? Yes. He is a great personal friend and I know him very well.
The Muffin Man or Wishart?
Both of them, actually. Although I secretly think he might be the Muffin Man.
Muffin Man?
Mm-hmm, the Muffin Man.
So we've got Judas Gray. We've got loads. So we'll start. Oh, that question. We'll leave that to the end because it's a great one. What guys would you like to wrestle?
All of them. But yeah, no, specifically, I actually have a long list. Oh, sorry, microphone. A long list of people, especially local people that I want to wrestle. He's on that list. Judas Gray has gratefully wronged me, because how dare that man be that pretty, and how dare that man's eyeliner be better than mine? So at some point, I'm coming for him.
That is incredible. That's 2 weeks in a row, because the Casino Brutale episode was the same, that he just, they just got annoyed that he's so handsome.
Like, how dare he be that handsome and pretty? It's not fair.
That's the bit he's clipping. There you go. That's the bit he's going to put out. He's also put, create your own Scottish card. Actually, no, we'll leave that for a second, because this next question is probably easier to answer. Favourite match?
Of mine or in general?
It just says favourite match. He hasn't even put punctuation at the end, so it can be pretty, but he doesn't know how to use a full stop. So
my favourite match of my own so far was actually one we had for CCW and Kirk and Tulloch recently, which was my first four-way. I'm really sorry. Do you mind if I pause this for 2 seconds?
A few moments later.
Sorry. So what was the question?
That's all right. That's fine. Oh, God, this episode's not coming out for a month, so I can figure out my own editing, so it's all good. The question was from Judas Gray. Favourite match? We hadn't decided what it was, if it was
match
you watched or your match, but both.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so both. So my favourite match of my own was a Fatal 4-Way, which was my first Fatal 4-Way that we had in CCW in Kirkintilloch recently. It was myself, Aliss, Lexi Luxx and Daisy Jenkins. And it was absolute chaos, but in the best way. Also, this is going to sound bad, but during that match, there was a double, not clothesline, drop kick, double top rope drop kick spot where I landed. And the way we've all, because four people in a small ring, it's a lot of people. I had Aliss Inc. land arse first, just straight in my face. And there was just that moment of, I love my job. I get to do this for fun. This is just great. This is just fantastic. But yeah, no, we all had a great time. We all battered the living crap at each other, and it was fun. That's been one of my favourite matches that I've done so far. I think it's so hard to pick a favourite match out. Side of myself, because I'm a nightmare with my ADHD, because there's different categories of matches. I'm a nightmare, because I'd be like, my favourite type of this match is this, and this one is this, and this one is this. Do you know, actually, a match that I saw recently, because I'm really big in updating my favourites as well. Like, I know a lot of people have like one that they watched when they were a kid, and they're like, that is by far my favourite match. I'm far too chaotic for that. One of my favourite women's matches that I've seen recently was Trish Stratus and Becky Lynch in the cage match. There was, for so many reasons, but like one, I mean, they went for it. I mean, Trish Stratus has been doing this for a long time. I mean, she went for it. She, the size of that bruise in her head as well, the whole way through that match, just kept growing and growing. But I really liked that match for a lot of reasons, structurally, the storytelling throughout it, the effort that both women put in the whole way through it. It's actually very quickly become one of my favourite, I wouldn't say overall matches, but I'd say it's one of my favourite women's like cage matches that I've ever seen, just because it really felt like the two of them were throwing everything they had at it. It wasn't like you watched it and you were like, yeah, that's okay. Like, I watched it, I'm sitting going, holy shit. Like the whole way through it. So it very quickly became one of my favourite women's cage matches.
I absolutely understand your definition of has to be subcategories, because as much as I said, I'm not a big fan of things like death matches, and that's just not my thing I like to watch. My favourite match of all time is Mick Foley Edge from WrestleMania.
Yeah.
And in that top 10 somewhere will be Cactus Jack Triple H from Royal Rumble 2000. It's like, I don't like that style of match, because those matches are so well done and so structured to have a story. Kind of made the things like thumbtacks secondary, you know?
But I always think that when you're doing a match like that, I don't know, this is just my opinion, but I always feel when you're doing a match like that, it should still have all the fundamentals of what makes a good match a good match. It should have the storytelling, it should have the things, the weapons should be supplementary props to what's being told and what story's being told, rather than it being, oh, I'm just going to take a weed whacker and hit somebody with it because I can. Like, do you know what I mean? I feel like it needs to make sense within the context of what's happening. So when you get something that combines great storytelling with also just like, oh my God, did he actually just do that to him? I feel like it supplements the story rather than it being the whole point of us doing is I've got a light tube and some barbed wire. Let's see what happens.
Really, really are against light tubes.
it freaks me. I recently had James Blair, who we mentioned earlier, had sort of jokingly said to me at a training session, I'm going to take a light tube right to the face. I just looked him dead in the eye, went full like angry woman mode. He was like, no, you're no. He's like, no, I am. I'm like, nope. I am banning you from doing that. He's like, you don't have any authority over me. I don't care. I'm banning you. No light tubes. Nope. Said it. None. Not happening.
In the dead of
Anyway,
night,
sorry.
in the dead of night, in the corner somewhere, he's just smashing light tubes so you don't see him.
He's just breaking them up, being like, "Yee, she doesn't know."
Safer than drugs, right? So the last question, well, we've got two questions left from Judas, which is, first one's create your own Scottish card.
Oh, that's a lot of.
I'll supplement it with this last questioning, because that might be
Okay.
a match you put in. He's put Goths Battle Royal. Who's in it?
Oh, right. Okay. So me and him start with. Oh, big Goths Battle Royal. Oh. See, I would just, I'm a nightmare because I would want just to see every vaguely alternative person who wrestles. I'd just be like, come on. There's no limit on how many people we've got here. Just come on. Just come on. We get Casey Owens, we get everybody, just like anybody who's vaguely goth looking, we'll just get them in. Everybody's gonna be dressed in black, red, or purple, and we'll all just batter the shit out of each other. Sounds great. But I feel like if you're doing a goth one, it can't just be you're getting chucked over the top rope. I feel like you would have to. I'm really sorry. Somebody's at my door. 2 seconds, sorry. I'm so sorry.
2 hours later.
I'm so sorry. I had
Sorry.
a gas thing that was supposed to happen today, and I cancelled it because I told them I had to leave for that interview. And then they've sent him out anyway.
So there was
sorry.
a
So
bogus
yes,
gas man. Bogus gas man. There we go.
bogus man.
All right.
The good thing about being a wee town is I opened the door and I'm like, oh, hi, Brody. How are you? Sorry. So yes, big goth battle royal. I feel like you couldn't just have people chucked over the top rope for that. I feel like what it would have to be, there'd be coffins all over the outside of the ring, and you would have to get somebody into one of the coffins. Like, you couldn't just chuck them over a top rope. There has to be something more to it. So, like, we'll just surround the whole thing in coffins, and you'd only put out if you actually land in the coffin. There you go. And,
There you go. So that's your main
good luck
event
to you
then.
if you land on the side. Yes. Try to think. So, it'd be myself, it'd be Judas Gray, Casey Owens, definitely Molly. Who else is a big goth in Scotland? I'm trying to think, because most wrestlers are kind of alternative. At least in some way.
Trying to think
Oh,
what
my
kind of
brain's just going
qualifies
blank.
what qualifies
Oh,
you as a goth nowadays?
well, see, this is the thing.
Because you know it,
Nowadays it's very different. Everything's very mishmashy. Everybody just cherry picks from everything.
so if you paint your nails and drink Monster, well, I mean that's probably 60% of the Scottish wrestling roster. Full stop.
Yeah, pretty
So.
much. I think it depends on your definition. I think if and obviously if you're not in Scotland, and I'm about to say this, it's kind of, you might not get it. But I think if you're a wee Ned, right, anybody who Disney dressed like a wee Ned, has coloured hair of any kind, or has their nails painted, or is drinking a Monster, is a goth. They just shout at you from across the street, you're mad goth. I mean, I've been walking down the street wearing a bright pink hoodie before, and I've had it shouted at me. But I think, yeah, these days it's not really, there's not really so much of a classification unless you're like properly going like the full like goth makeup, goth spikes, everything. I think everybody sort of just falls into that vaguely alternative bracket. I think the stipulations on it would make it the goth thing. So I think you'd all have to wear like a certain dress code. Everybody would have to wear red, black, or purple because those are your vampire colours. Like I said, coffins. We'll send everybody out to either type O negative or the cure. My brain's going completely blank, and I'm trying to think of specific names. I mean, you'd have to have Zero in there. Like, if you think of weird alternative gothic people in Scotland right now, I think Zero is one of the biggest sort of names that fits that exact bill. Dude is just a horror villain out of the TV. But yeah, so far that's like five names, and I'm struggling after that because ADHD.
That's gonna be the question that keeps you up at night now. That's gonna be the one that
It
where
will
you.
be. Do you know, I'm probably gonna send you like a full typed up like graphics made card now. Just like, I haven't slept for 3 days, Billy. This is my full answer. Here you go.
If you're still watching this episode, we may have that at the end
Yes.
if it doesn't. So yeah. So I guess that's the same for the match card as well. They've got the Goth Battle Royal, but I mean that we know how wrestling works. I mean, people in the Battle Royal can have matches beforehand, so you can get yourself
Yeah, I
infused
think if I was going to have like a full, say I was going to have a full six match card, there's like you obviously have like the introductory match, so like first one you would want to have like two staple people who you know are like good workers, set up the tone, have the whole crowds like if they don't know what wrestling is, that first match shows them. But I don't know who I would put in that spot. For some reason, my brain's pure screaming Andy Roberts because he's just, he's the man to show people how to do shit.
And then get like, him gothed up like, from the main event. Get him all gothed up.
Oh my God. Imagine if we gothed up Andy Roberts. Just get some eyeliner on him. We'll put some wee spikes in his hair. We'll get him some leather. I think that'd be amazing. We'll just make that the theme for the whole show. We'll just goth everybody up. It'll be a full Judgment Day like card. We'll just make everybody dress like Rhea Ripley.
Oh, I'm now I've got Andy Roberts in Rhea Ripley's gear. Yeah, that's a vision that I'm seeing Andy on Saturday at Arthurmania. That's not something I'm going to get out of my brain for a couple of days.
You can tell him I've ruined your mental image of him for you.
If I somehow get him on the podcast, there will be a moment where you can watch my eyes just go,
oh, Ruby ruined this for me.
Yeah, just looking him up and down, but it's for another reason going, stud bra. There he goes. Fishnets. Oh, no. That's them as well. They're on.
Yep.
Oh, right. Sorry, Andy. I'm not objectifying you there. I'm sure you'd look lovely.
Not at all. You'd look smashing. Yeah. Great calves.
Exactly. I just don't need that vision in my brain at this moment in time. I don't know where to go from there.
We all need that image.
Yeah. Anyone with Photoshop out there? So we've got Andy as a goth.
I definitely like to get Mike Musso on that show. I love Mike. He's like,
he looks like a cracking goth as well. I think Mike would look like
a goth. Imagine him doing like a full, like an almost Taker style gimmick, but making it more of his kind of 80s style of big, tall, blonde wrestler. I think that would work great. We could just have gimmick swaps for everybody. We'll just get them all to be mad goths from history of wrestling.
So I interrupted your point about Mike, sorry.
No, you're good.
Could I be Doink the Goth?
We've just had a suggestion from James Blair that he be Doink the Goth.
Well, instead of the colours, it would just be black and purple and red.
Yeah, we'll just get him done up like, what is that guy called? You know, the black and white mime. The really famous one from history. My brain's just gone blank. It's not Pepito, but you know what I mean.
I'm just thinking of Bon Voyage, but that's from Incredibles.
Yeah, that works too. Oh, that's better. I like that. Yeah.
This is just James looking for a double payday because I'm assuming he's wanting to be on the card as well.
Oh, so. I definitely. Oh, I sitting at the corner winking at me going, hire me. You know, you want to hire me. Go for it.
I could do two enough characters. okay, so I think that's enough to get us started for a goth or goth show.
Yes.
As it seems like everything is against us at the moment between folk trying bogus gas men, internet, and everything in between. We'll march our way to the wrap up. I can't remember if I asked you the question about sheep and cows and dinosaurs. Do you off chance remember?
You did. I am trying to remember. So right. The whole thing was sheep and cows.
Okay.
I can't remember what my answer was last time, but sheep are faster than cows, but cows are like, they weigh a lot. See, if a cow just lies on you or sits on you, you're not moving. So I maintain the cow would win. The sheep might be small and fast, but I maintain the cow would win. I've seen one kick a man in the chest before and it is brutal. Cows for the win.
I've seen a sheep beat a cow. I'm just saying, I've seen a sheep beat a cow. It's just a sheep, so you know
that's fair. That might have been that one exception sheep. He's just like roided. He's got into the water supply. He's roided out his brain. He's just like, let's go, I'm a sheep. And then the dinosaur question, was it favorite dinosaur?
It is, yeah.
Can't remember what my answer last time was because I feel like this has also changed, but
I think a lot of people answered with actual dinosaurs until people started going rogue and going for cartoons and stuff, like, which is still an absolute acceptable answer.
Mine is usually, so I'm assuming everybody who's watched this will have seen Jurassic Park because it's part of history and you should have done. Mm-hmm. There's the wee guy, I can never remember what the name of the dinosaur is, but there's the wee guy with the gills, like the the heavy guy who's stolen the embryos is escaping, and he falls in a mudslide, and there's just this wee thing appears out of nowhere, and then suddenly, like, he's gills or whatever come out, and he's just like showing, and then spits in his face. I don't know why, but I've always loved that wee guy. He's weird and he's different. He looks small, but he's dangerous. So,
I think I would know these ones by now because I've asked it so many times. But it's a Dilophosaurus.
Yes, how could I forget that? It's like the easiest name ever to remember. Yeah. Anyway, yes,
Dilph, Big Daddy Dinosaur.
Exactly, right. Big Daddy Dinosaur.
So before I wrap up, I was trying to think of names because, of course, you're back onto the show. So I tried to do a tagline for episodes. Unfortunately, Omar Muhammad took the best one straight away, which was Electric Boogaloo. But for you, I've actually put some research in because I'm not a big horror movie fan. And I looked at sequel names. And Halloween 3, I think, might have the one. It's called Season of the Witch. So I'm thinking Rubi Roberts, Episode 2, Season of the Bitch.
I love that. I love that so much.
There we go. That's a wonderful way to wrap up. So, this episode's coming out October 13th. If you want to plug anything, plug your socials, plug your TikTok, plug shows you've got coming after that.
Yes.
That you know of that can be announced. Plug it all.
So, social medias are the same as they were last time. It's Rubi Roberts, spelled R-U-B-I, on most platforms, or Rubi Roberts BBS. The only one that's different is TikTok, which is Rubi Roberts 0. And you can find all of my content on there. T-shirts wise, I'm now producing my own t-shirts. I mentioned it earlier. I make my own bleach tie-dye Rubi Roberts t-shirts. I don't know if you can see that very well on there. But if you're looking for one, just send me a wee DM and we'll organise it, and I'll send it out to you with a wee signed photo as well. And shows, the only one that is happening after this that I'm plugging right this second is actually the day after this comes out, which is the CCW Loughlin of Dame Spotting 2. So I'm in my own local area and I've issued an open challenge, so just waiting to see who opens that.
There we go. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking the time for a catch up. And
no problem.
That's it. Hopefully next time, maybe we'll see you, because if you come back up for WTLs coming up to Elgin in October.
Yes.
So possibly I'll see you again then. But
yes, hopefully.
For now, that's it. Have a good one.
Thank you very much.